Okay, hello, hello, hello. Hello. I'm checking right now. So, I think, yep, we are live. So, as always, welcome to the number, I don't know, maybe 6 Live Solutions number, I don't know. So, if you are getting for the first time right here, this is my space for you to answer maybe most of your questions. So prepare your questions, prepare your some of your doubts for the instrument, for theory, for everything I can, you know, help you. So, I always say that, maybe I'll get tired of saying it really soon, but English is not my first language, maybe you know this, so please be patient, and maybe we can communicate in a fair enough way, you know. I think I have some vocabulary in my hands, but it's about the accent, maybe. You let me know. So, first of all, remember, following Cover Solutions in Facebook. I'm currently updating there. Twitter, not so much maybe, but if you can, you can follow me. Of course, the channel right here, and very important, you know, that's why I'm here, and that is Patreon. You can check it out, patreon.com/coversolutions, and you know, for most of you maybe already know what's about the page, but if you don't know, you can pledge some amount of money, you know, and help me, and by the way, help, of course, in your learning, because I will be playing the song that you want to play, you know, that you want to learn. And in exchange, I will be receiving, you know, the amounts are very little. You can pledge one from 1 to maybe $50 per video. So things are going quite well with the help of Patreon. I had the chance of, you know, having some busy time and moving from one place to another, and here in Chile. Chile is my country. So, for every one of you that are already watching, we're going to start very soon. Thanks to everyone. I know you're a little quantity of people that watch all of the videos. I'm not pointing out, you know, I don't want to be so massive, because I couldn't help every one of you. So I can't figure out what's the best time for you, maybe the best hour. Right here in my country, it's 6 o'clock. So you can let me know if that's for you, what's the time, what's a good time maybe, and I can adjust this, because I never know when's the good time, you know. But I want to get back to this. I want to buy a better camera for this, and I want to be doing this more regularly. So let's go on. So hello to Mr. Jerry Beans. Says, how do you buy a bass? It's easy, you know? You need money and a store, and you buy a bass. Okay, first question, really fast. Mr. Alpha Da Fool. Hey man, I love your playing, but I was wondering, do you know all the notes? Or you play mostly by tabs? Okay. So, let me check out the sound here. Stop the music. It's enough. Okay. Please let me know if you hear everything correctly. I haven't been warming up, so maybe I'm a little cold. So, what was the question here? I forgot. Okay. Do you know all the notes? You play mostly by tabs. Yeah. One of the things that tabs don't have, and I'm really struggling to maybe think of an idea of implementing. It's that you can't really, when you play a tablature, have the notion of pitch, you know, of the notes. You know, you see in the tablature, you see maybe a 3 here in the A string, and you don't know what that note is. So this is C, and so on. Every fret is a note, and the way to practice most of the learning of the notes, and it's very important, it's very basic for every one of us to know. And I really encourage everyone, you know, don't just read tabs, you know, try to read some music, some score, some, you know, in the classical way, so you get some feeling of the notes. But you know, you can play this note, and I know it's a C, but it's maybe because of the years of learning and whatever. But if you implement, you know, some scales, the numbers can also be a way for you to learn the notes. Yeah. Sometimes in my head, I think, okay, this note, it's an F, and I can say it, but I also visualize in my head, that's the eighth fret in the A string. So I have a kind of a tablature mind right now, and actually I can play easily things that are written in tabs more than in score, you know. It takes some time to me. Of course, it's about time practicing the thing, you know. I really don't like people, you know, throwing so much shit to tablature, because it's just a way to learn, you know, to learn to play. The important it's here, the important thing. You know, it's in your fingers, in your playing, and that's just a way of learning, you know, a song. And it has some qualities that in the matter of you know, the amount of time you will need to play the song, you know. And that is because this is a C, but also this is a C, and it's in the same pitch. So you can play some things here, but you can play it right here. So the way of the tablature is letting you know in which part you are, you know, in which part of the fretboard you are. So I think that's very, very important, you know, in order to play really fast song. But yeah, if you want to learn, first of all, the notes, you need to know the name of the open strings, of course. I hope every one of you know that, and you know, you have a E, A, D, and G. I have to, in my mind, you know, I say it in Spanish, and you know, so it's not that easy. Okay. Is the Toros the only bass you have? Danilo, Ielenevsky, you know, there's always some name that I can't read. Yes, the Toros is the only bass I possess right now, the only one, and I'm aiming to, you know, getting some money to maybe improve my equipment, really pace by pace, you know. But I'm really proud of this bass, you know. I think it has a fair enough sound, and I always say it, and I think I'll always say that. You don't need a $1 million instrument, you know. You just need to take care of your instrument enough, and everything else is in you. So I think that's one of the main goals of the channel, and I like that all of my videos are played in this bass that it's quite cheap, actually. So I have some exercise for you before we start, you know, the question part more in depth. And I've been getting into a lot of scale practicing and arpeggios, and I really have want to improve some of my playing and some of my theory playing, you know, in my mind. So here's the first exercise I want you to practice, and it's very important. It's about learning, of course, the names of the notes also. So this note right here, it's C in the E string, 8th fret, and from this position you can play one of the many positions of the C major scale, that is the most basic scale of all time, if I may say. And of course it's C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C. Those are the most important notes for you to understand throughout, you know, all the fretboard. And of course you have a lot of positions, but we'll be focusing in this one, you know. The same thing right here, you can play it right here. So it's 8 fret, 10 right here, this is D, moving to the A string in the 7, 8 and 10 we have E, F, and G. So C, D, E, F, G. And we finish with the D string and A, B, and C. tone, C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C. This is the basic scale, and this is not the exercise. I want you to practice this. I'm sorry. This is kind of a pattern for most of all for working out your fingers, but also working out, you know, the knowledge of everything, you know, of the instrument. So I think it's very important. So we start here, C, D, E, and we get to E, we will be getting back to C and going one step further, you know? So C, D, E, C, D, E, F, D, E, F, G, E, F, G, A, F, G, A, B, G, A, B, C. Okay? Very slow. Okay, here it is. On, you know, with the same intervals. And of course we can go back, so it's right here. So, if you don't want to think about it in notes, you can think about it in numbers, you know, like the tabs, and it's 8-10, 7-8-10, and you go throughout these four frets. So, so you have that, and if you manage to get this exercise right here, I think you will have some better you know, strength in your fingers. Maybe it's a good warm-up exercise. So let's finish with repeating, you know, the exercise from slow to fast, and that's it. I will be trying to, you know, maybe getting some exercise for you in one stream, and from now on it's all questions for you. That's it. So if you want to practice it, it will be very helpful for you, I really think so. Again, so this is a most of a place, you know, for you to leave your questions, and not much about put in your request, you know. I know there's some songs I need to do and some songs I, but maybe if you, if I tell you, you know, I have kind of like 3 or 4 months of just pending songs that I have to work on. So it's been hard and it's a lot of work, but I will be playing, you know, some of the most popular tunes that you want. So okay, I have some other question maybe here. I feel like this is more of a guitar question. Okay, what does AH stand for in TAF? And how is it done? Say AH on the 12th fret of the A string. It's probably harmonics, but you know, there's kind of a deal with harmonics and notation, you know. I've seen a lot of different ways of inputting, you know, notation, but in bass and guitar you have a kind of a two range of harmonics, you know, natural harmonics and artificial. So natural harmonics are quite the most easy, if you may say, and it's all about this harmonics, natural harmonics, this. You can play some artificial, you know, I don't really get the definition, because it's not quite artificial, but you can maybe do some tricks for getting some other harmonics, you know, like this. When you play a note in the 12th fret and again tap it in the corresponding octave, you can get some other sounds also. That's a kind of a harmonic also. You have a that's more of a, like a guitar harmonic, but it depends most of us in the song, you know. There's not a, you know, the tablature being so popular in the construction of it, there's some things that you may see in some tabs, and in some other tabs are quite different, so it depends a lot. But yes, maybe some other question. The thickness in the picks, Mika's the I lost the name. So I don't really use much different picks, but I have some kind of a really thin tip pick and a really, you know, fat pick for some things, but I don't possess really so much variety of it, you know. I encourage, of course, of having a lot of you know, material to practice and material to get your sound, you know. If you use a really thin pick with a bass, it's not quite recommendable for you. So I think you need some higher thickness. Okay. Okay, any exercise for speeding up right hand technique? Yeah, I have some Actually, I have some videos in the channel, but let me think about something else. Okay. So most of you will have more trouble. You know, if you're entering bass from guitar, the trouble will be mostly here. You know, in this hand, because you need to get more practice in this hand to be fast. You know, if you play guitar, maybe you're familiar with this. You know, playing the left hand. But if you're not, of course, it may be a little harder to play right here, because you need a lot of practice and time and stamina to get some fast playing right here. So maybe a quite good example of it, it's, you know, I kind of forgot, but if you want to play Hysteria and you're a beginner, you will have a kind of a bad time, you know, because it's a lot of constant notes and playing fast, and you will be getting so tired, you know, in this hand. You will kind of burn your hand, and it might be harmful for you. So if you want to, you know, get some better hand, right hand technique, the most important thing maybe is having some patience, you know, because and starting slowly, of course, but it's all about playing constant notes and knowing your limit, you know. And of course, position of your hand, it's very, very, very important, you know. If you have a relaxed position of your hand and fingers and have a constant, and not move around too much, you know, and be kind of efficient about your strength and energy, you know, it's really difficult to play Hysteria. You know, when I recorded it, I really don't think I was quite capable of doing it without so much effort, you know. I had some bad times with it, so I recommend you to try to play maybe that tune, and maybe watching some of the exercise I have in the time, you know. But something important, it's about most of the position of your fingers and warming up, you know. Warming up, it's kind of like an exercise for every one of you, and you really need to do that, really constantly playing some warm up exercise. Maybe the ones that I give you, or the ones that that you can invent for yourself. So let's get going some other place. All right. When I play live, when I start slapping, I lose some tone, you know. It's really harder to hear. Some tips, Mr. David Imperiale, maybe? Okay. The tone in the slap, it has kind of a two ways of you know, getting worried. It may be about the way you play it, and it may be about the structure of the bass itself. You know, if you have a well adjusted bass, you know, the strings are quite low, it should get some tone, you know. But most people try to play slap and fail mostly because of the sound and because it hurts in the first time. So I will use your question to remind everyone a good slap position. Maybe it's not your case, but I will try to redo some exercises right here. So when you want to go to slapping, the first thing, it's the position of the right hand, and it must be right here because you want to, you know, get the string slapping the fretboard. If you do it right here, it might be kind of harder. So, but some people actually do some things right here. So new strings also help in the tone, and you can figure that out for yourself. But you can also slap with old strings, so it's not that a big deal. If you're not getting, you know, the tone that you want, like I said, it might be the bass or it might be you. So if it is you, it's a thing that I can maybe help you. But if not, you need to adjust your bass and maybe go see why is it not sounded that well, you know. So there's kind of a different approach to slapping, and I wanted to talk about that in a more, you know, specific way. And I was playing some Flea stuff that I'm going to upload really soon. And if you notice, Flea, when he slaps, it's kind of a more resonant way of slapping that most of the other players, you know. You can play something kind of in the style of Flea, and you will play like this. You know, getting much resonance, but maybe you can play like this. And that's all about muting, you know. When you mute a lot or mute little, you'll get much or less resonance. So it's just a thing that I noticed and I wanted to share with you. Try to get your own style, you know. I'm kind of trapped in the way I do this channel because I don't have kind of a my own style, because I always want to emulate, you know, the way of playing of most of the bass players. I want to upload the bass cover or whatever. So of course I in my band or whatever I have my own style, but it's important to know much things about style of other person, of the other people, to get your own style. So notice how do you do that? How do that player does that way of playing, you know? But let's move on, I think. What's a good method for improving finger independence? Okay. I think finger independence in the case of an instrument like a bass or guitar, it's much about you know, getting the two hands working together, you know. I don't know if you refer to maybe left hand or right hand, but you let me know. So I find it so much harder to read tabs than normal sheet music. Do you know any good sources to find free sheet music? I wanted to let you know that any tab that you can have here in the channel, you can download it actually, and you can you know, with some software like Guitar Pro, you can actually see the score, and it's quite easier. But I really don't know. There's much of a tablature preference, maybe because it's easier, yeah. But it's also because it has some complexities on its own, you know. But there's some complexities that help you most in the way of playing, that most in the way of processing, you know, with your brain. So I don't know, but you can check out the software that I told you, and maybe get some transcriptions right there. Any tips on tapping on a bass? And that's always interesting. Okay. Tapping on a bass, maybe it may be not so much different from guitar, you know. But you have a guitar, and you maybe will play something like this. And you will get much sound of it if you have distortion or whatever. But in bass, you have to be a little more rough, I think. So if you're playing this, maybe you need a little more strength in the tapping, you know? I always give that exercise, but maybe I'll change it, okay? Do something like that. The most important thing is hammering with a good strength, you know, and good precision. And when you're tapping, you really need to let go of the string, not by just letting it go, because if you let it go, the sound will be lost. Kind of much, so you really need to let it go and also play a little bit, right, you know, to the side. Right to the side, so you maintain, you know, some of the sound. But there's some other types of tapping, I think. You can watch some of the Mudvayne videos, I think, and you have some more of a harmonic tapping, like I showed some time ago, like I did when in this type of playing, you know, you're tapping just to give some sound to this. And you give some harmonics out of it, you know. That is a kind of a more percussive tapping. Yeah, you don't have to tap to the side. You have to just do this, you know. And also you have more harmonic precision right here, in this like I showed you some time ago. And that it's also tapping and really fast letting it go, you know? I think that's most of the tapping you can do in bass. There's always some crazy person that that has some other idea about it, but I think that's the most basic. So, tips on scales I should learn first. I cannot get the major and natural minor scale, but I don't know which ones are the most important. So, most people think the most important scales are a lot of scales, but it's not that much, you know. You have first of all the major scale, like you said. You have the minor scale, and minor scale has some variations in itself, you know. This is the minor natural scale in the key of A. We start with the fifth fret and it's 5 7 8 5 7 8 5 7, or A B C D E F. I'm sorry, B C D E F G A. So that's a minor natural scale, and it's derived from the major scale. You know, it's kind of the mode, and modes are kind of the approach, you know, to a more complex harmonic. And if you are, you know, doing solos, improvising, modes are very important also. So if you want to maybe, you know, get into modes, you need to know about the major scale, you know, in the full way. And modes are also given from this scale, you know. If you play from C to C, you have a Ionian mode, I think you call it. And if you play from D to D, you can change the position. That's Dorian, and so on. So if you play from E to E, it's Phrygian and whatsoever. You can check out that in most places. But I think if you have some knowledge in those scales, you have some good basis. But I really think the blues scale in the popular music, you know, it's the most important, in my opinion, you know. Because you really have some of the feel, some of the history, and some of the, you know, the virtuosity of most popular players, you know. If you, of course, you can't just live with the blues scale, but if you have some good some knowledge of the blues scales, you will become quite fast a good musician in the eyes of people, and of course in the eyes of yourself. So blues scale, I have some videos in the channel, and you can check it out. I think 90% of the music you hear may have the blues scale incorporated, so I think that's important. Okay. I get some comments are stuck. I'm sorry. Okay. Okay, now. You know, tips on learning slap, like I said, you can check also some videos, but I will be trying to give you some exercise, and it's kind of a spoiler, I think, but I think it's good enough for you to practice, you know. So I'm working on a song from Red Hot Chili Peppers, and it's called The Power of Equality. And it has some short riff, you know, of slapping, and it goes like this. So if you take that from example, you know, the most important thing, like I said, it's position, you know, playing right here in the beginning of the fretboard, having good wrist movement, you know. You don't want to be doing this with your hand and your arm also, you know. You don't want to play like this. You want to just use your wrist. That's very important. And from your wrist, you will get the slapping and the pop. So for the slapping, it might be easier, but you really need to play with this bone of your finger to get some percussive sound. And really fast, if you want to improve your popping, maybe you will need to suffer a little bit more, because you really need some hardness in your fingers, you know. And once you get that, things might be a little easier, you know. And when you play something like this, that is the best way to start, you know, having some notes and playing an octave like this in the 4th fret, and also the 6th to get the octave right here. This is a C sharp and C sharp in the higher octave, and you position yourself right here, and when you go down with your finger, you really need to rest, you know, the thumb in the next string, you know, in order to get some of the sound, or you can also slap hard enough to get some resonance out of it. And doing the same with this finger for the popping, it's kind of easier to get some sound. You need to pinch the string. I think that's the most important advice for slapping, and the harshness of which you play, you know, the instrument depends on the player, you know. You can't maybe play a flea if you're going to play like this. With some little strength, you really need to give some slap, some good slap to the bass, you know. But it's just practice, you know. Okay, moving on. Most of the time, you know, I'm closing with with some playing of myself. Time goes by really, really fast, and I'm sorry if I can't answer most of your questions. I really wanted to get back to this, you know, to be in contact with some of you, and also remember you to keep practicing. And I want really soon to start doing a quite a, you know, accurate lessons about some specific issue, you know. I really want to do a live stream about how to read tablature, you know, in all the problems that you may have, and I really want to do that, but I want to improve my camera. I think it's important. So I've been a bassist for 20 years. Your videos still come in handy. Saves me from hanging to learn the songs by ear myself. I'm really grateful about those comments. Thank you. I'm not talking in Spanish. It's just because I think most of the people that watch this and are from, you know, English speaking countries. I have no problem with, I also like to improve my English. You know, I really appreciate the patience for every one of you. So let me search from some new questions. Okay. I have some difficulties in playing the intro riff from the song The Pot by Tool. Can you give me some tips? Okay, let's do that. Okay, let me open the tab right here. The Pot, okay. So, most of you might know the Tool, it's in drop V tuning. And we'll be getting to this. Okay, where's Tool? The Pot. So let me tune down. Here's a tip for everyone trying to, you know, using your ears to tune up or down. I don't need a tuner to tune to drop D, because you have D here and you can have some of some reference, you know. So I'm down tuning the E string with respecting, you know, this string. And of course it's kind of muddy if you play like this, but you can play in here in the octave. Kind of a good tuning, you know. So for this intro, we have to use a pick, and it's like this. Is mostly repeated, you know. So there's some difficult things and really interesting things to learn right here. Okay, first of all, when you're doing pullouts, you have to respect the same thing I said to you about tapping. You know, you have to pull out the string and also give some sound to the note that comes after. So if you do it like this, okay, let me see. If you do it like this, if you just you know, put your finger and let it go, you will not get some of the sound that is important, you know, and it will sound kind of poor, you know. It will sound like this, but it also will sound less notes, so it should sound like this. And for that, you really need to give sound to the open string also with this finger. So that is most of the things that some people get wrong, and the other things is about you know, rhythmic use of the line, you know. So rhythmically, it's kind of difficult, you know, in tool in general, you know, it's kind of difficult rhythmically. So that part is most about you know, listening well to the tune and getting the line well. But in about technique, the most important thing is this: getting a good sound, and the picking should be. You can do all downstrokes, or do it like me. You can alternate. You know? When I'm doing the open string, I'm doing upstrokes. And I want to respect the timing of the up and down and upstroke, you know. If you are in a 1 and a 2 and a 3 times, you know, beats of the measure, you really need to always do in a downstrokes, you know. But you let me know if that's the case for you. If it is about the sounding, it may have something to do about, you know, the thing that I just said, the thing about the pull out, the pull off, in it's very important, you know. Most of people think that doing hammer on some pull off if kind of, it's kind of a subtle way of doing it, but it's not that that subtle, you know. You really need to take care of every note, you know. That's very important, I really think. So I started playing bass a week ago and I really enjoy it. I got some problem with ghost notes. Ghost notes while slapping, like Tell Me Baby. Some tips. Okay, let's get to that. I think this is the last one. I will put the music while I will be searching for Tell Me Baby. Okay. Tell Me Baby. Okay, it's here. So the main riff, it's right here. So we have this. Let me tune back to standard. When you want to tune your bass, the most important thing is knowing about harmonics, you know, in this place. If you play harmonic in the seventh string, it should sound the same as the I'm sorry, 7th fret. It should sound the same as the 5th of the upcoming string, you know? So if you play harmonic of the 7th in the G string, it should sound the same as harmonic in the 5th, the D string, and so on. So when it's down tuned, you will notice some kind of a flapping of the tone. I just down tuned the D string and check it out. Can you hear the dissonance here? And now here, while I'm tuning up. So here we are. Okay, Tell Me Baby. So we have a lot of ghost notes in between, and that's very important for the sound, you know. So in order to get this well, you really need to apply knowledge in both hands, you know. First of all, you really need to know about ghost notes in the essence, about not slapping, about you know, just playing. When you do a ghost note, the most important thing is, you know, slightly pressing right here the strings, but not through the wood, you know. You really need to just slightly put your fingers on the string and get that sound. Yeah? If you do it with one finger, it might not be so much of a ghost note. It might sound like a harmonic. So you really need to use a lot of fingers. So if you go slow down the thing that I just did, you know, this. Let's slow it down a lot. So I'm always taking care in this hand, the left hand, about having a lot of fingers put on while I'm doing the ghost note. So the first ghost note here is, and that it's more of a percussive ghost note, and it's proper from the slapping technique, and that's what I wanted to go, you know. When you're playing ghost notes, you know, with plucking, you have just this kind of a ghost note, you know, this kind of muting. But when you're slapping, you can also play it right here. And as long as you have the hand put, you know, dampening the strings right here, you will get this sound also. So you can play a lot with this. So you can, there's also kind of a percussive playing and ghost note that you can also do while slapping right here. So kind of a primus thing, you know, but that's another thing. So when you get here, you do the first ghost note goes right here, and it's kind of a more of a natural way of thinking it, because when your hand goes down and presses the fretboard, you will get instantly, you know, that ghost note. So you have that note goes here. And the next one goes, you know, right here in the popping. So this thing is the thing that you really need to practice about, you know. It's having a neutral position right here maybe, and slapping and popping, slapping, popping, slap, pop, slap, pop. And that should be the sound, you know. When you're doing the pop, it's kind of a hard way to do it, and you really need to get some more pressure, you know. If not, it may sound a bit like this, and you don't want that. You really need to get some click, you know, pa. You can alternate between an E and D string, and then with a A and a G string. Once you get that, maybe you can advance, you know, and get some some good lines here. That's all about slapping. I think it's a very rich technique if you get it done very well. You know, it's really different doing that line just like this. Without the ghost notes. Yeah? It's very important. So let's maybe move on to another ultimate question, or maybe we will be going home for now. You know, it's been a lot of time since I did this, and I kind of forgot, you know, what it was, and there's it's difficult to get some dynamic in here, because it's kind of doing a personal lesson for a lot of people. So I'm sorry if it's not the thing that you expect, you know, but I'm doing my best. I'm really doing my best. So for you, how difficult is it to create music in odd time signs, you know, 7-4, 5-4? I'm writing an opening in 9-8. You know, odd time signatures are mostly not that hard if you think about it in deconstructing them. You know, if you think in a 7-4, like you example, you can think of it, you know, like a 4-4 and a 3-4, you know, mixed together. And so on. You can always decompose music into its essence, and it will be a lot easier. So I really don't think it's that hard if you really have a good basis, and that's very important. You know, having a good basis of your theory and your. I really want to do some theory live stream. You know, sometime. Just about theory, maybe having a board, maybe having some you know, tablet in which to write in, or some program, and just talk about theory. You know, I think it's very important, of course. So maybe some other time. Good finger exercises, you know. I'm always going back to this one. I think this one is the most important. For me, and it's about knowing all of your bass. You know, I'm always doing this. And going through all the bass and exploring which part it's harder for me. Of course, it will be hard to go back. And so on. So I really think this is kind of basic but very important, you know. Once you get this and you're kind of a more you know, a little harder in your in your hands, you can play some other things, but this is the very best for me, you know. I don't play that much with three fingers, but you can also implement three fingers right here in the same output, you know. So you have a kind of a complexity about three fingers. It's getting good accents. You know, you should be doing accents on the one. I'm not changing a lot, but yeah. So, okay, I really don't know much about a double thumb technique, and I know it's kind of a always. Always people ask me about it, and I have to be honest, you know, I'm not well learned in that way, but the most I do, it's maybe things like this. Playing, you know, in that way, but it's not, I'm not quite good, I really think that. You know, it's kind of more advanced thing for me, and I want to get better in it. Yeah, but one thing I really do know, it might hurt if you do it wrong and if you don't have a kind of a strengthened nail. You know. And I'm not very good, you know. I'm not ashamed to say it. So maybe I'm not your man for that thing. But there's a lot of other videos maybe you can watch. But don't worry, I'll get that really soon. You know, some exercise maybe, some other song. You know, eventually I think things will be getting much more complex. Through time, you know, when I've already covered some of the most basic songs, I really think most of the things I've done, it's quite basic, you know. If you get into bass in a professional way, you know, you really need to get some other things too, and I'm hoping to get them. I like using a pick, and I like also using fingers. I really like it. And I think it's mostly because I have some backtrack in guitar that I really like to get back to pick sometime. But if I have to maybe do some, you know, prefer some of the one of the two, it'll be fingers, you know, because you have a much more good time, you know. Not having to worry about something other than yourself, you know, your bass, maybe some cable, and your fingers, and you're done, you know. Mm-hmm. You can play whatever. So I really like that. How do you strum fast? I mean, if you do it strumming in bass, you can do it in most, I think, two ways. It's the most important. The first is kind of like a guitar, I think, with nails from the fingers and from the thumb, and also this kind of a primacy way of doing it. And that way, it's always people ask me about that, and a way to say it more easy. It's you really need to spread your two fingers right here and retract them with some strength also. So the first part may be easier than the second. The second has some slapping, some harshness in it, you know, for you to play it correctly. But there's also kind of a this way of strumming, also more like a flamenco way, you know, spreading your fingers, you know, one by one. yeah, okay. So let's finish with some other thing and we're done, I think. It's been an hour and I really don't know. You know, time goes by. For galloping technique, you know, when you go to a song like you said, you know, The Trooper, it's kind of hard, you know, getting to this. Especially because you're doing, you know, two fingers, and that's all you need for the song. But the most important thing is defining what finger will be, you know, the strongest, you know, the first time, and starting, you know, really really slow. The thing with most metal and rock, hard rock covers, is some people played it, but not with enough, you know, strength and attitude in the playing. You know, not much in your face, not much in your clothes. You know, it's most in the playing. You know, you can play just with attitude. You know, you really don't need to show off to play with attitude. You know, and that's important. If you play like this, you will get to the end of the song, sure, but if you play like this, you will have some strength and strength in your hand, you know. And that's what you want. So I think it's been a lot of time right here, and I'm really hoping this helps. You know, that's of course it's easier for me, you know, to sit down and answer some questions, but it's not that I want to do some easy videos, you know. I really want to answer some of the questions that are most people want to know, you know. And please stop asking me about the brand of the bass, you know. Everyone should know. If you go to the description, you have all the year that I'm using, it's right there. And you know, I get like 10 or 20 comments a day, you know. What's the brand of the bass? What's the bass? What's the bass? And if you, I know it might sound kind of annoying for me to say, but there's a lot of in the internet that you can figure out by yourself, you know. I really don't want to give everything to you. I really want to give you, you know, the basics and maybe some guidance. You know, a teacher, it's a good guide. It's not the one that gives you all the answers, all the everything, you know. A good teacher is a good people that say to you which way to go. You know, you have to do your work. You have to do your work, basically. So I will be closing this, I think. Maybe I'll play something until every one of you go. Okay, let's do this. And thanks a lot, everyone. Please remember the socials, because I'm always, you know, wanting to get in touch with you. You know, remember Facebook, remember Twitter. And also Patreon, because Patreon is everything to me, you know. I'm working for them, I'm everything. So if you become a patron, I will literally be your slave in a way. So come on. I don't know why everyone is saying Tool. Please someone explain to me, because I'm going, so... You want me to play it, or...?